Hi, I'm Dr. Natalia Serrano, and this is a Behavioral Health Consultation Podcast. Thanks for listening in. Today we're going to talk about integrating the medical aspects of a patient's care into a typical behavioral health consultant visit, particularly ones where you're being asked to, by the primary care provider, potentially in a warm handoff, to maybe address a mental health issue. But one of the key pieces to making care seamless and fully integrated is actually to be fully aware of what that patient's care is like, including the physiologic aspects of their care. So even though you're being asked to have depression or anxiety, which are the typical things that a primary care provider comes to aspects into your understanding of a patient's care. And in doing so, you become kind of a physician extender in a way. You do what's, you perform a key function for the patient and for the medical team that's really important. That's a key piece of the behavioral health consultant model, which is that kind of idea of overlap between you and the primary care provider. If you've heard my consults before, you know that we've talked about how through the process of working together as a team, the medical provider and by extension his medical team get better at the behavioral health stuff, the mental health stuff, by virtue of their contact with the behavioral health consultant over time. But the reverse is true as well. The behavioral health consultant gets better at the medical stuff. And over time, both get to a place where they both have pretty good facility with each other's domains. And that overlap is really crucial to a well-functioning team and to consults with patients that are truly integrated and seamless. So the starting place for this, particularly for young BHCs, is really just curiosity. You want to start off with a sense of wanting to learn more about what it is that happens in the exam room before you walk in. And of course, the best way to do that, one of the ways we do with our trainees, is to actually have them shadow a primary care provider. So that's something you should be doing quite often early in your training, and even periodically after that. It also can help actually to have joint visits every once in a while. Most behavioral health consultant visits in most settings tend to be warm handoff base. So the provider gives you the patient, you walk into that room, they walk in to see their next patient. It's just a more seamless way to work it in primary care. But there are some situations where you might be talking with a provider and there might be an issue and you might actually decide to walk in together into the room and observe the provider or participate in the visit with the provider at the same time. And that's a great way to get to know what's this provider's style, what are they talking about on the medical side of things. It's just a great entree. But in either case, you want to start off with this idea that you want to learn. And the best way I've found that happens is really just learning as you go, learning case by case. As you review patient charts, and as you have questions, as you talk to your providers and ask them for clarification. For example, there might be a patient with hypertension, and you might want to just be curious and ask the provider, well, how well is this patient's hypertension managed? Are there any issues that you're facing with that? Again, even if the consult that they're providing you for is maybe something for depression, that curiosity is how you're going to learn and how you're going to develop an understanding of that individual provider's practice as well. That's also very, very true, of course, for medications. Learning one medication at a time is absolutely crucial. So That curiosity is really a good starting point. Now, what I do before I go in to see a patient, which is crucial, again, both for learning and for just being able to understand what's going to happen with that, what's happening with that patient, I review two aspects of the chart before I just go into the notes. One is I review a patient's problem list. And again, I'm not just looking at for the psychiatric diagnoses on the problem list. I'm looking for all the diagnoses on the problem list. Now, in particular, I'm looking to see, do they have problems that are chronic in nature? So do they have diabetes, for example? Do they have some form of a chronic pain disorder? Those are really helpful for beginning to understand what a patient's life is like. And they're helpful because we also know that they coexist with psychiatric diagnoses to a high degree. With medications, when I review the list, I'm looking for things like, are there complex regimens? And again, I'm not just looking at the psychiatric components. I'm looking at other medications. Is this patient diabetic and has to take medications several times a day? If that's true, then that's a fairly major part of their life that I really need to know about. And I'm also looking on that medication list for things like complex medications that just introduce complexity. Could be complexity of monitoring, so it could be a psychiatric medication like lithium, where you need more regular lab monitoring than perhaps other medications. I'm also looking for medications that could be red flags, like pain medications, or if I look in their history of medications, a variety of different kinds of pain medications, benzodiazepines, which could trigger kind of a sense of wonder about how long has this patient been on benzodiazepines and why have they been on benzodiazepines for this period of time when by and large benzodiazepines are much more better for situational issues. So all of these just give me a sense of the totality of that patient's care, both on the psychiatric and on the medical side of things. That's really, really crucial. And again, you learn each time you do it, and as you see new things, you just look it up. These days, a simple web search is really effective. Otherwise, resources like UpToDate, if your organization or institution has access to, you can really read in 5 minutes and learn a great deal, and it'll stick because you've reviewed it in that case example. So reviewing the problem list, reviewing the medications, and then of course reviewing the chart notes. And when I review chart notes, I'm not talking about reviewing, reading them through. You have to be very efficient here. So reviewing the problem list and the medications probably takes me about 30 seconds or so. And then I'll spend another 30 to 60 seconds probably just reading through the last behavioral health note if they've seen behavioral health in the past. Reading through the last PCP note to get a sense of what's going on there and what they've been working on. And then, of course, in the handoff itself, or perhaps as a result of reading this, I might actually go back to the provider and ask a clarifying question. In the handoff, I'll often ask, did you make any changes today with their medications? Were there any changes in their physical health status? And that's a quick and easy way to get a bunch of information about something that the provider may not be telling you, but might be quite important for you to know going into the consult. Now, once you get into a consult, again, assuming this is something that's really psychiatrically related, you don't ignore the medical side of what's going on with the patient. You want to keep it in mind. You want to be aware. And sometimes I'll actually selectively start with that to help increase the seamlessness of my visit with their visit with the primary care provider. So I might say something like, hi, I'm Dr. Serrano, and go through my typical introduction and say, so I realize that you've been here today and you had an extensive visit with the doctor around your diabetes, and I wanted to make sure I understood that part of your life before we jump into other aspects that are affecting you. Can you tell me a little bit about how life has been like recently living with your diabetes? And that's just a very quick way to kind of introduce the idea that this is not just about us talking about your depression or your stress or anxiety, exclusive of all of your medical issues here. The interesting thing is that patients will compartmentalize just as easily as the health system does, and just as easily as sometimes primary care providers do. And that's why we have to kind of break through those walls, because there really are so many intimate and intricate connections between how a patient's doing with their body and how they're feeling about their life and how they're doing in their relationships and other aspects of their life. What you're shooting for here is a kind of a seamlessness in the visit for the patient between what's happening with the primary care provider and what's happening with you when you walk in the room. So again, even if you don't start off with the physical health diagnosis, having it in mind comes in really, really handy as you're talking about other aspects of their care. And I might drop some things in throughout a consult. For example, we might have been talking about the patient's depression and some of the triggers for their depression. And I'll say, well, you know, I can imagine how with all these things that you have going on, how it's then that much harder to take care of your diabetes in the context of all this. And that, again, allows the patient space and opportunity to bring that part of their life into the consult and to educate you about how hard it actually is to manage all of these things. Now, a couple of quick exemplars here. Let's take the kind of the traditional case of a diabetic with depression with high hemoglobin A1C. You know, first of all, again, if you don't understand what a hemoglobin A1C is, you know, I didn't go to medical school to learn about it. You don't need to. I asked physicians about it. I did some reading about it. And I continue to stay curious about it because one of the things you have to understand is that medicine is always changing. And the standards of care change quite frequently. So just some simple curiosity. But, you know, with a diabetic with depression, again, I'm always curious because it's such an intensive chronic disease to live with. You have to monitor and manage a lot of things. You have to monitor and manage your diet. You have to monitor and manage your exercise, your activity level. You have to obviously be monitoring your blood sugars, taking medications, usually more than once a day. So there's a lot that happens there. So I'll often ask a question about, as I spoke earlier, you know, what is it like to live with your diabetes? How much do you feel like it kind of takes over your life? Or do you feel like you feel confident in the way in which you're dealing with your diabetes? That's a great question to ask. That's kind of simple, straightforward. It's not, you know, you're not kind of delving into necessarily a huge ball of wax. But it gives, again, creates that space for the patient to do it. Sometimes I'll ask the patient, you know, I'm wondering here, the provider, you know, A1Cs are important numbers for the provider, but I'm wondering what the important numbers are for you. Are they the number of times that you're able to feel good in a given week? Is it the number of times that you take your medication well? What are the numbers that are really truly meaningful for you? These are all ways in which, again, we might be talking about depression, but we can integrate these other aspects as well. Another very typical patient is, say, a chronic pain patient, say someone with fibromyalgia. And again, if you don't know what fibromyalgia is, it's thrown around a lot. You know, it's interesting because I remember years ago when I asked the provider that for the first time, and, you know, their response quickly let me know, you know, medical professionals don't really know what fibromyalgia really is. You know, it's really an... a syndrome that's not terribly well understood and baffles a lot of providers as far as the management of patients day to day. But it often coexists with anxiety. So you might be asked to go in to see a patient with fibromyalgia, but you're asked to kind of deal with the anxiety component. But it's really hard to deal with the anxiety component if you're not actually also understanding that patient's experience of pain. So I'll often open a consult, especially to diffuse the patient's concern that I'm in there to kind of label them as crazy when they feel this very real pain in their body. I'll start off by saying, you know, I realize that day-to-day life has to be really, really difficult for you, and I want to understand what your experience of pain is. Could you describe me, to take me through a typical day, and how often your fibromyalgia gets in the way of life? So again, a great way to just kind of create that space for the patient in the consult. And, you know, starting with probably what's their main concern, the anxiety, not the anxiety, but the chronic pain. And then from there, I can begin to make connections to how living with that uncertainty of how they're going to wake up one day versus another day creates a state of anxiety on its own. So these are all ways in which it's really easy and important to integrate the physiologic aspects of what a primary care provider is working on with their patients, as well as attending to the behavioral or mental health side of things. Now, of course, you will be called into consults where your specific job is to work on, say, some sort of behavior change. It might be the diabetic, but you're being called to ask them with lifestyle management, maybe figuring out a way to eat healthier or to exercise more. These are consults as well where you can also then do the reverse, where you're attending to the physiologic aspects or the behavioral components strictly, but you're also keeping in mind the other side of things, the depression, the anxiety that might be present, the other kind of behavioral contingencies that might be there. I find that behavioral health consultants are a lot better at doing that, kind of going from the physical health part and connecting it back to the mental health part, than, of course, going from the mental health part and connecting it to the physical health. But again, it's an art. It's something that you want to develop over time to be relevant, relevant to primary care providers and relevant to their patients. All right, hopefully this has given you a few ideas. The important thing is the starting point. Just be curious. Read the whole chart. Get a sense of the whole patient's life. The more you know about it, the more effective you're going to be in your consults, the more helpful you're going to be to patients, and the better consultant you're going to be to your primary care providers. All right, hope this has been helpful. I'm glad I snuck another podcast in here. Hopefully another one in the next couple of months. For the Behavioral Health Consultation Podcast, I'm Dr. Natalia Serrano. Thanks for listening.